What's up, everybody? Welcome to IGN Game Scoop. I'm your host, Daemon Hatfield. Joining me this week here in studio is Justin Davis.
Scoop.
In the flesh.
I'm here.
And we're also joined by Sam Claiborn.
Game Spookies.
And Mark Ken Medina is here as well.
Yep. I'm here, Daemon.
If you are listening to this right now, this is one of those instances where you might want to pop over to YouTube and see what this show looks like today. But we do have a great show. What a show we have for you this week for our Game Spook episode this year. We'll talk about Mario Wonder. Sam has been playing a little Alan Wake 2. I want to get his thoughts on that. I wrote Alan Wake 2K in my notes, but it's just 2. We're going to check in.
Alan Wake 2K. Okay.
We're going to check in with our recurring segment, Real Mature Video Games, which is going to be really good. But first, I've got some things to share. Where to begin? Okay, first, a helpful PSA from a hero, an unsung hero in the IGN Game Scoop Facebook group. It turns out you can still download Angry Birds Star Wars.
Oh.
You can. All you have to do is go to the App Store, click on your profile, then go to Purchases. It'll show an alphabetical list of every purchase you've ever made, and you can download Angry Birds Star Wars. I did it, so I have it once again on my iPad.
I feel like I gotta like, because like that's eventually... Huh. Eventually, they're gonna shut that stuff down, right? Like, nah, anything over 10
years old or whatever. Do it now.
Yeah, so it's like anything. I need to, like, I have an iPad that has like 100 gigabytes free. I probably need to go through and get all those classics loaded up onto it so I have them.
Yeah, so that was.
You would have had to purchase that, so it doesn't eliminate the fact that
that's true.
Cannot
if you,
buy
if
that
you never
game,
purchased it, you're out of luck. Mm. But if you did already purchase it like I had, you can still download it.
I have literally every mobile game ever made from the time, from the olden days of IGN.
Yeah. I mean, that's where you were hired as. You were the mobile game editor.
Mm-hmm. One of the very first games I ever
I feel like
reviewed.
I'm missing. Mark, I feel like I'm missing something.
Last week.
Why do we care about Angry Birds Star Wars?
Well, it's a great game, first of all.
Also, sure, okay.
You besmirching Angry Birds Star Wars.
Here we go. My bad.
It was last week's Video Game 20 Questions game, Mark.
Oh, did you guys get it?
Yep, they got it.
Okay. Yeah. Sorry about Choo Choo Rocket. I would have never got that in a billion years.
Oh, boy.
It's okay. We also have something to share that a fan sent in, a little craft project here. I'll pull this paper.
Show and tell.
Little Lego IGN game scoop.
That's great.
Yeah, and it came with a note.
That's awesome.
It came with a handwritten note. Scoop! Hello, I'm Nick, and I'm currently listening to Game Scoop all over again. I'm currently in the February 26, 2011 episode about Batman Arkham City. Oh. I like Lego, and I got artistically inspired, so here's my gifts to you to enjoy. And it comes
amazing
with these things, but I don't, this is like, I think this is a lightsaber. It has, it has Lucasfilm written on it.
Yeah.
And this is like a pen, I think.
Okay.
And then there's just this blue piece. Yeah, very cute. Thank you, Nick. What does it say? The P.S. I really enjoy your Starfield commercial and Pandora. I guess, so on the audio podcast, when Starfield came out, there was some ads about Starfield that I read. I guess he was talking about. Glad someone appreciates it. Someone posted in the also in the Facebook group, and I think they're in another country, a European country, and the ads they were getting on GameScoop were for dildos.
Oh.
Which is
wow.
Like, I mean, like, fine, whatever, but like, what does an advertisement for a dildo even sound like? Mm. Like, you know, I mean.
There's only one way to find out.
There are many options for dildos. I'm not even going to try this. Yeah. I just. The other thing I wanted to share is a book I just finished reading. Ooh. This is The History of Sunsoft, Volume 1.
Oh, cool.
It's very cool. Oh. And this is a very cool little package. Covers everything from Sunsoft was just an electronics company in Japan. They were not a video game company in the 70s, but then in the late 70s, early 80s, when video games started to take off, like a lot of other electronics companies, they wanted in on it. So they started making clone arcade games, clones of Space Invaders and that stuff. And then their first hit, do you know what their first hit was, Sam?
Good question.
I'm trying to think. I can't think of...
It was kind of a clone. It was Kangaroo, which is basically a clone of Donkey Kong or Donkey Kong Jr.
So that's confusing, though, because Atari published Kangaroo and made the and manufactured the cabinets.
In the U.S.
Yeah. Well, I mean, like, how many people played Kangaroo in Japan in 1982? Probably
I don't know.
But a lot of people in the United States did. But that's interesting. I didn't know it was Sunsoft developed. And Atari, you know, published games from lots of developers like that.
Sure. Mm-hmm. But this is a really interesting read. Speak and Rescue was an arcade game from 1980, the first ever arcade game known to implement speech.
Not Sinistar.
Sinistar was a couple years later, I thought. goes from when they opened up Sunsoft of America in 1986, and they've got pictures and interviews of all the employees there. They even have like pictures from their holiday parties sitting around the Christmas tree, which is very good.
And what crucial license did they land? Looney Tunes.
Well, I mean, yeah.
And Batman.
There were several of them. And then, of course, their first, you know, what sort of like started the golden age of Sunsoft was Blaster Master, the default video game 20 questions game. And there's a whole section about
that's right.
It was heavily translated from its Japanese version. Its Japanese name is Cho Wakusei Senki Metafite, or Superplanetary War Record Metafite.
Yeah. And someone,
someone in the U.S. is a, let's just call it Blaster Master.
Yeah, some like marketing dude, like they earn their keep by like, wait a second.
Yeah.
We should just call this Blaster Master in the U.S.
Lots of
plus
folk
they
colors.
Changed the story to be about a frog.
Yep. They did add the frog in there. Anyway, they go on. They did a bunch of the Tengen releases of like Xenophobe and Alien Syndrome and Afterburner for the NES. Anyway, it's a very cool book. It ends leading up to 1990, and then the volume two is going to cover when they have the Batman license and so on. It's two more volumes planned. History of Sunsoft volume one, I recommend.
Nice.
Okay.
I like the, I want to do like Game Scoop show and tell more often.
I mean, you're welcome anytime, Justin. Anytime you have something to show and or tell.
Well, I don't have anything. I'm in the flesh in Los Angeles right now.
In the flesh. Because it's a Game Scoop episode, we have to say it like that.
Yeah.
Or I mean, a Game Spook episode.
Spook. Next time I'm in my office, I'll do a show and tell.
All right, Super Mario Brothers Wonder. We've spent a week with it, and I think everyone is pretty happy with it. Is that safe to say?
Wowie zowie.
Yeah. I think that's the only new voice recording, which is why, like, did they really need to recast him? Couldn't they, everything else, they have thousands of recordings of Charles Martinet saying. I think wowie zowie is the only new thing.
I think they've said wowie zowie before too. But you know, Mitchell had pointed this out on staff that it's whenever he's doing just like his basic climbing off the wall grunts and stuff, like when he's doing like
right.
jumps and stuff like that, it sounds a lot more like Mickey Mouse than Mario. Yeah. And that does sound different.
Oh, that's funny. Well, I think maybe I'm wrong. I think the voice actor also does the flower, right? Too. So did that
love
voice
the flower.
Too? Okay. I believe so.
Oh, yeah.
The flower has some good commentary.
The flower.
Yeah. He says some really funny stuff.
The flowers
there's
don't
one point
me.
Where you, there's, they what? They what?
They don't bother me. I saw some like.
Why would they bother you?
I saw some, like, I think another publication posted an article. Here's how to turn off the flower commentary and some Mario Brothers. Yeah.
No, it's
it don't bother
great.
Me at all.
There's one point where the flower is like, you cut to a little secret area and the flower is staring off into the distance. And he says, "What a beautiful waterfall."
Yeah.
And then if you walk a little bit further away, he says, "Leave me to my waterfalls."
Yeah, it's good. Mark, lay it on us. I think you love this game.
It's great.
Yeah.
So my second favorite Mario of all time is Mario World. And this is like, I don't know. I guess I didn't get it from the trailers that this was more or less just a spiritual successor to Mario World. But it so is. It controls like it. And I really like new Super Mario Brothers, but I'm kind of glad that they are like, this is a 2D Mario, not a 2D Mario that plays like a 3D Mario.
Yeah.
No, I think it's great. I think every level's like, I didn't expect the Wonder Flower. I didn't expect one in like every single level. So they're all so good. They're unique. I'm playing through the special levels right now, and they're great. They're hard if you want to try to get all three coins on one go, but they are super fun.
Which you don't need to do.
Which you don't need to do. No,
but
you don't.
But you do need to do it if you're making a guide video and you're assigned to do it, which is what Mark is doing, which is awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. But no, I love it a lot. It's great. I'm glad that I was able to, you know, have that privilege of finishing Spider-Man. That way I could just play Mario Wonder. It's super fun. I love it.
And but I want to clarify that you can get the purple coins and you wait a couple seconds. If you don't die, if you're on solid ground and then you die, you'll save a purple coin will be in your inventory. Hmm. You don't have to do it all in one go, which is different from previous Mario games. It's a little easier.
Sam, you were also not quite sold on that first reveal of Mario Wonder. How are you feeling?
Oh, yeah. It looks so crappy. it previewed just okay, and then I got more excited for it. And, it, you know, what they did with this game was they hid what they should hide, these amazing level transformations. Remember Levolutions?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They hid the Levolutions.
From Battlefield?
Yes, from us as the big twist, right? And so that's great. So now it's not just this like flat, boring new Super Mario Brothers game. There's these really cool level twists. However, what I also like about it, which another thing they wouldn't have shown in a preview, is that the map has secrets and there's like little things to discover on the map. There's secret exits and worlds that lead to a special world. All the things that you might remember from games of Mario's past that are great, like Mario 3 and Super Mario World. So because it has those neat influences from the 8-bit and 16-bit era, I'm like totally on board. I still think like, I like the animations and everything, because what I was really worried about originally is like, is it going to be weird? Like, is it going to feel like there's extra frames added and things are going to feel weird? And it turns out like, no, like it feels better than the previous Mario U games to me. And like, there's just a lot, the action feels great. The game is wonderful. And I will just to say one other thing about it, and that's that I was shocked that after playing a whole lot of it, I still wanted to go back and play a lot more Spider-Man. So I've been switching between those games.
Nice. So you haven't finished Spider-Man yet?
Nope. And I haven't finished Mario Wonder because Mark and I are on a crew of people that divided up a bunch of things to cover in the game and just to kind of spread it out. And because of that assignment, I've been playing very specific stuff. And then I play for fun at night. So I've been going through the special world and stuff like that. And, you know, I'm absolutely going to 100% it. But Spider-Man, yeah, I'm just to the kind of, I don't know, I guess I'm mid-game. I hear it's longer than you think it is.
I did finish Spider-Man, and yeah, I still love it from end to end. Definitely one of my favorite games of the year.
Me too.
It's great. But Mario Wonder, I love it as well. One thing for parents out there who are hoping to play with their kids, my son who's 4, he was really excited to play. He loves Mario. He's played so much of Odyssey and 3D World and Mario 64, but Wonder's too hard for him. The 2D wow, platforming man. Is much more of a challenge for him than just running around the open areas of the 3D world.
And I've heard Wonder is not a pushover to begin with.
Yeah, that's
like,
true.
Even for adults, like it's not, you know, it's not some like game where you can just breeze through it with your brain off.
Yeah. I mean, it has its fair share of easy levels for sure, but you can see the star rating of difficulty before you jump into a level. And there's been a couple
of I like that.
They're more difficult and I've died a couple times and I'm like, okay, I'll come back to this one later. I want to keep pushing forward. I think I'm in like the third world.
You know what's cool though is if you're playing a level and you are having trouble, you can think about why you're having trouble and maybe there's a badge that can help you.
Well, so I was just like, going to ask.
That's another thing I love about it.
I was just going to ask if you guys have been using the badges.
Yeah, of course. Oh, yeah. The timed jump where you get a higher jump on your second jump is great. The parachute cap is
the parachute cap
awesome.
Rules. I just use the cert. I because of the way, again, like we've been playing it for writing about it.
Yeah.
I've been using the sensor badge basically exclusively. But when I switch to levels, I told that I'm not. I'm playing for fun. Like I mainly use the parachute cap. I love it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'm really excited. I've been on a work trip, so and I can't take the Switch because we only have the one Switch, and I can't deprive the children of the Switch for the time that I've been in LA. So I've had to wait to dig into Mario Wonder. But like, you know, Mark, you touched on something which I hadn't given a ton of thought to is, 2D Mario games. They're not interchangeable. They have really different physics, and Mario has a really different moveset depending on the 2D Mario game that you're playing. And it was really hammered home for me. Whatever year Mario Maker 2 came out, like I was obsessed with it. Like I think I played hundreds and thousands of Mario Maker 2 fan levels, and like that was my thing for months. And like that really crystallized for me that I don't care for the new Super Mario Brothers moveset. And I don't think anybody's a big fan of the art style, but even just the style of physics in those games was not, I just don't like it.
Yep.
You know, and
you're not crazy. There's comparison videos that show what it is. It's mainly momentum and it's like Mario like doesn't stop as fast in the in the new Super Mario Brothers games. And this one, they basically tried to match the keyframes and motion to Mario World. So right, it should feel like you expect it
That's the best. And so that's a big one. The momentum's a big one. And also like jump height and floatiness, like the arc of Mario's jump. And so anyway, like, yeah, I'm really excited. I thought Wonder, I've been excited about it from the jump, but now I'm even more excited.
Yeah.
When you see a turtle and you're holding Y and you jump on the turtle and he goes into a shell, you land on it, you automatically pick up the turtle shell and then you can click it up. Or, like, it feels like you're just playing the Super Nintendo game again. Yes. And a lot of people are getting that Super Nintendo Switch controller to play the game.
That's
and
smart.
I wish I had one because I'm playing where I'm using the D-pad on the Pro controller and it never feels like great. But yeah, it really feels a lot like Mario World.
I'm just gonna be a total degenerate, and I have the GameCube adapter for my Switch. I'm just gonna play with that.
Okay. Ooh, yeah, I'm just playing with it. Until Mark just mentioned it, I'd never even tried the D-pad, which is crazy because I'm usually a D-pad hardcore player. But like, I've just been using the analog stick, and it's been totally fine. I wanted to say, Daemon, one thing that I can recall very clearly is the first time I played Super Mario Brothers 1. I was, probably 6 or 7 or something like that. And it was, all the rage. It was everywhere. I only played the first 3 levels of that game. Like, I don't think I ever got to Bowser. Yeah, to like 1-4, let alone like really understood. I could warp to probably, 4-1, but barely ever beat that. And I probably played those for 2 years or something. Like, I don't know. Like, little kids, they don't need to play a bunch of those levels. They just play the first ones over and over again. Yeah. I think that's what I remember then later playing Mario World with, like, friends that had little siblings. And they, like, would only have the dinosaur area ever unlocked. And I was like, what's happening here? There's more to do in this game. And that they just, for years, they'll just play those Dinosaur Island levels or whatever the first world is.
Yeah.
Donut Land? I forget what it's called.
Those new Super Mario games, they made everyone soft. This is what Mario Wonder's like, when we were kids. It's not hard. It's just back to how it was, how it's supposed to be.
Yeah, start the whole game over, kid. Or you turn it off. You turn it off and go outside.
Yeah. Yeah, Mario Wonder is great. I'm really enjoying it. And I have my copy of Alan Wake 2. I'll fire that up tonight. But Sam, what have been your first impressions of Alan Wake 2? IGN gave it a 9 out of 10, by the way.
These are very first D impressions. that review is awesome, by the way. Check it out. It will probably sell you on Alan Wake 2. And like, I don't know if we have permission to play spooky games after this holiday that's coming up. Yeah. So, try to get it in before then. I wanted to, and I wanted to talk about it a little bit. But yeah, what my initial impressions is that Control really was had some interesting influences, like Inception and Twin Peaks, for example. This game is like from the start feels X-Files like, and especially because you are kind of like walking around with 2 FBI agents in those classic FBI jackets in the Pacific Northwest where all of X-Files was filmed. And, that's kind of like a cult killing plot. And that's so cool. Like, I just love that they nailed those X-Files aesthetics and vibe. And I'm so excited about that. It does start a little bit plotting because it's like saying, like, you go to your mind, what do they call it in the game? It's not Mind Palace. Mind Place, but they refer to a Mind Palace.
One
they're like, this is this. Yeah, they're like, this is her version of what others techniques have described as the Mind Palace. So they refer to Mind Palace, which is interesting. But yeah, you go to that and it's kind of like posting stuff on the wall. And there's a lot of that and like investigating crime scenes. So just be prepared for that. But the intro is actually a separate thing, which is like a scary you're playing as a victim section, which is really cool. And it's very, very like steeped in horror tradition. It's very, very creepy. So it's good. So all that aside, I can't wait to play more. There's puzzles in it. There's things like that are like, attractive and some crazy monsters. And we'll talk about it more next week. One thing that's bugging me about it, we just kind of talked about with Mario, which is kind of funny, is that the voice actors seem a little bit like imposters. This keeps happening. And I did my research and I looked it up. Like, they're all playing American characters, but they're not American. So at least the main character, especially, not an American. And they slip. They slip their out accents, of that accent. Yeah. It's like, remember Heavy Rain with the origami killer and stuff? Like, and like, it takes me out of it a lot. Like, not a little bit, like a lot. I've been watching a couple of TV shows which are doing this. And the main one was, what was the?
Silo?
The Vault.
Silo.
Silo, yeah, yeah.
That show's so good.
Yeah, that actor, that main actor just slips out of it. And it's just, I don't know. It's like, you don't need to hire American actors, but there needs to be a little bit of QA on this, especially when it's a game like the first thing that comes up, written by, produced by, directed by. Like, they're going full cinematic in this, and it's like, it's kind of bad acting. That's not to say it's bad writing. The fact the writing is kind of cool, because you get to, if you put it on subtitles, you're like, oh, these are cool lines. They're just delivered in a really strange way sometimes that your just normal everyday American life, you would not just say this thing this way.
Yeah. I guess it's worth mentioning, though, that Remedy is not an American company. They're not an American development studio. So,
but they love setting their games in America.
Yeah.
I'm so glad it turned out good. Like,
me too.
You know, I'm not a big fan of spooky games, and I actually didn't love Control as much. I thought it was fine. I didn't love it as much as many other people did, but I'm still like, I'm rooting for Remedy, and I'm rooting for Alan Wake 2, even though it's not my thing, just because it's been such a crazy year, and there was this narrative of like, man, is that game going to get buried and completely overshadowed? And now, man, it's here, and it's making like a much bigger splash, and I think people expected it too. That's awesome. Like, that's so exciting.
I would also put Remedy at this point, it's approaching that Insomniac level for me,
for sure.
and like of making next-gen games and being really crap. Like, despite what I just said, like, you will not believe how good faces look at points in this game. Like, it is unbelievable. Like, there's these close-ups of faces, and you're like, it just looks so photoreal and good that, like, I'm so impressed. And then, you know, there's the foliage everybody saw, you know, like the forests and everything, and the lighting. Like, it's just mind-blowing. And, you know, playing this in this Insomniac game at this time, you're like, whoa, we're so lucky to have these kind of companies making such amazing, well-playing, like, non-glitchy next-gen games. It's so cool.
Is there a built-in previously on, or do I need to watch a recap on YouTube?
As far as I could tell, there was not anything like that, and I didn't care, because it immediately, like, I just would not do it.
Okay.
Just see what happens. See if you need it as you go along, because it's about a different character from the start.
Yeah. Okay.
Quick question.
Yeah.
Quick question. Who's the main character of Silo? Is it not Rashida Jones? I've only seen the first episode.
Oh, my God.
Oh, no.
You should watch it now. You should watch it.
I've seen the first episode. That's it. Okay.
I mean,
I love Rashida Jones, though. One of my favorite actors.
She's great.
Yeah, because I was like, you're talking about an accent. I'm like, I remember Rashida Jones having an accent in the show.
She's American.
Yeah. Well, because I love her.
Also, related to a cast member of, she's the daughter of the Donna on Twin Peaks. So Twin Peaks connection there.
I'm watching Ted Lasso right now, and it is great.
Wait, in season one?
Nice.
No, just finished season two. I can't stop watching it. I barely started watching it like a week ago.
So in your opinion, season two was also good?
How much am I allowed to like spoil?
Well, don't spoil
even
it.
If it's just kind of minor.
I just thought season two was abysmal, whereas I love season one. And then it comes back up again in season three.
I don't think it's abysmal. The Nate character, I don't know what they're doing with him.
Yeah,
he does a total heel turn.
It was not earned. Yeah, that's a big problem for me.
The ending of season two makes zero sense.
Yeah,
I'm like,
it's scary though. Like, it's emotionally impactful, I think. But they try to retcon it basically in the third season.
Oh, weird. Okay, yeah, I'm gonna start the third season tonight. But I finished.
Well, I'm
season
just referring
two.
To the poster and stuff like that. They have a little bit of flashback things, and they try to like kind of explain stuff.
I just, where did it come from?
That's what He's that just was like, my issue too. Like, they just didn't know what to do.
Well, he gives the explanation. I like his explanation where he says, like, I thought I was the special person, and then you took your eyes off me, and then it ruined my life. I thought that was really interesting.
They didn't build up to that at all. I didn't catch any of his complaints. I didn't catch. The only thing that can make it is that they expected us to think that because he hired Roy, and he was like very jealous of Roy, it seemed, that we were supposed to be like more affected by that. But like, there was just that one look, and then it's never really mentioned again.
But they don't.
So I don't know where that heel turn.
People root for Nate in season one because he's the underdog, but he is mean and rude. He's mean and rude to the towel boy. It's like there's a little bit of like a narrative, like, you know, you're like, you root for this character, but it's like there's definitely an undercurrent of like, ooh, maybe you're not such a good dude. But
also, Keely
that's
did
what
nothing
I like.
To deserve
I think
him,
it's
like, trying to kiss her like that came out of nowhere.
The towel boy stuff is a really good example of like, you know, them developing this character that they try to make sympathetic, and then it's also kind of like there's something going on there.
Well, and it's
I don't know, I thought that was the part I liked about the second season, was that kind of shocking payoff. Because I thought it was like if you go back and look at the subtlety of that character developing, you're like, something off with this guy. You know, yeah. I think that's more interesting than making a villain out of, you know, obviously villainy.
It's that big moment of him roasting everybody. That's also like a big bit of like negativity and meanness that's played for laughs in the moment. Mm. But it's like, ooh.
I think it would have been better if he disappeared halfway through season two. That if that moment had happened halfway through season two, and then at the end of season two, they show him. But it's like that reveal. I'm like, we just saw him 5 minutes ago. This reveal, how did he even... Like, this is... I don't know. Okay, anyways, sorry.
I can't believe we're talking about Ted Lasso.
I know. We're spending too much time here. Let's move on to real mature video games. This is our segment where we take a look at upcoming M-rated games, and I've mined the ESRB's database for what is in the game that earned it its M rating. So I will start describing the things that earn these games, and these are upcoming games, unreleased. Mm-hmm. I'll start describing the content as disclosed by the ESRB, and we'll see if you guys can guess the games.
So, you said they're all upcoming games.
All upcoming.
Got it.
As yet, unreleased games.
Got it.
Okay, in this first game, the F word and S word appear in the game. Mm-hmm. During the course of the game, players can visit hostess clubs to improve bonds between party members. Players can select from various hostesses, dress in bikini tops and hot pants, and watch them dance on poles.
It's the Yakuza. It's a Like a Dragon 2, the new Yakuza game, whatever it's called.
Yeah, do you know the name?
What?
Like a Dragon.
It's Like a Dragon. Infinite Wealth. Yeah, you got that very easily. Yeah. Was it the Hostess Club?
Yeah. 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 It's a whole thing.
Yeah.
It's really fun too.
This is a role-playing game in which players assume the roles of ex-Yakuza members battling criminal syndicates in Hawaii. Hmm. Nicely job, man, Justin.
I can't believe they used the term hot pants. You don't hear that
hot
much.
Hot pants, yeah. That one's coming out on my birthday, January 26th, next year. Okay, second game. Upcoming M-rated game. The S-word appears in the game. Mm. Cutscenes depict instances of violence and blood, such as a character stabbed through the eye, a character shooting themselves in the head off screen, a child being hanged in a ritual, a character impaled,
Death Stranding 2.
And a character torn in half.
Is it Death Stranding 2?
Combat is highlighted by realistic gunfire, impact sounds, and blood splatter effects. Shooting sometimes results in enemies bursting into pieces and or being dismembered or decapitated. From a third-person perspective, players explore a manor residence, interact with characters and battle mutated creatures.
Manor residence. It's Resident Evil something.
This is a survival horror game in which players assume the roles of a woman and a private investigator searching for a missing relative.
Woman and a private investigator searching. What Resident Evil game is this? Is there a Resident Evil coming out? I don't even know.
It sounds like Code Veronica, but I didn't think Code Veronica was.
No. Is it a Silent Hill? Those wouldn't have ratings yet.
Yeah, it's not Silent Hill, but I can reveal it. It's definitely a game that's taking inspiration from Resident Evil. It's the Alone in the Dark reimagining.
Interesting.
I don't like this B-roll.
Yeah, from what the description there sounds like, they're very much going for a Resident Evil vibe.
I don't like creepy dolls.
I don't think anybody does.
When is that coming out? Is that this
January?
Year?
January.
January.
It got delayed, I think, right? Because they were like, there's too many games. I think they delayed it. I can't remember.
Yeah.
Spooky New Year.
Okay, last one. Another upcoming M-rated game. The game contains frequent alcohol content, a female hostess drinking alcohol and encouraging redacted to drink, stores and bars where a player's character can purchase and consume alcohol, and a status icon denoting redacted's intoxication status. Redacted can also interact with female hostesses, going on dates and unlocking video clips of women in revealing outfits. The game contains references to sexual material like I like to try a variety of sexual positions and now I'm throbbing so hard it hurts.
My.
Cutscenes depict additional acts of violence, a man depicted from behind repeatedly stabbing an unconscious character, a character stabbed through the head, a man shot in the stomach. Players can perform scripted special moves, slamming enemies' heads into walls or the ground. And this is an action adventure game in which players assume the role of redacted, a former redacted in hiding.
I mean, is this a different Yakuza game?
Yeah, it's the other one.
Yeah, it's the other one. Yeah, oh. It's the one that's coming out.
Like a Dragon Gaiden.
The hostesses are the giveaway. Yeah.
This one's out next
that's
month.
Great.
Early November.
Man, when that like these games, it's like, okay, so yes, technically maybe there's a character getting stabbed when they're unconscious and another character getting stabbed through the head. Yes, I guess all that's in the game. But when you spell it all out like that, that makes it seem so different. It's like these games are like very lighthearted and silly. Look, he's fighting a bear with a chainsaw. Yeah. That man's in his underwear.
Look how violent.
Yeah. Yep, that's good. When you boil it down to just the content that earned it its M rating, it sounds like a different experience.
Oh, man, those games are so good. It's been a couple of years since I've played a Yakuza game, which means 11 of them have come out in the time. So it's like, I'm excited. I'll go back through. I can't remember. I was on a journey to play through them all, and I can't even remember where I stopped. Maybe I stopped at 6.
I'll definitely play Infinite Wealth when that's out in January. So speaking of real mature games, and also speaking of games with a lot of alcohol content, I have to showcase the latest Nintendo Seal of Quantity title. Have you guys heard about this one? I hope Tom has this ready to go.
Yeah.
A real game.
You got in trouble,
a real
right?
game you can buy right now on the Nintendo eShop. Need for Spirit Drink and Drive Simulator is the game.
Oh no!
Need for Spirit Drink and Drive Simulator. Get ready to embark on a wild journey as a hapless professional driver tasked with delivering alcoholic beverages to various celebrations, all while battling the perils of abysmal roads and your very own addiction to the booze you're transporting.
Okay. So I was very concerned of like, is this a drunk driving simulator? And then I was relieved where it's like, oh no, he's just delivering the booze.
Nope.
But then I got concerned again where it's like, no,
he's getting high on his own supply.
Yeah, he's addicted to it now.
It's rated T for teen.
You can play it before you're even allowed to drink.
I think it got removed from the store, right?
It was only removed from the UK eShop. I'm looking at it right now in the US eShop. It's $1.99.
Oh, okay. Yeah. You know that they in the UK they say drink driving and they say instead of drunk driving.
Yeah, I mean, I learned that just from this game.
And just like in New York, they say they're waiting online instead of in line.
Mm-hmm. They also wait in a queue.
Yeah, that's true. I don't think that this is a responsible video game that this exists, but like. Need for Spirit's pretty clever.
You like that?
It's a fairly, it's not just, an endorsement of their content, but, like, it's a clever name for a video game.
It's just, once again, no one is watching the gates at the Nintendo eShop.
Sleep at the wheel.
Anyone can put any game they want to up there. Okay, now... Another special treat. This brings us to the October 1990 issue of Nintendo Power.
That was it? There's no more video game? Real, there's no more video Nintendo eShop video games?
This week? No. Oh, not really. Okay. No. Yeah. That was the one to highlight from this week.
Got it.
October 1990, Nintendo Power. On the cover, Maniac Mansion.
Cool.
They did their own little sort of like clay representation of the mansion and the characters. And oh man, was the NES firing on all cylinders at this time. There's so many... awesome games in this issue.
And Solar Jetman.
That's right. In the player's pulse, in the letter section, we have a letter from Nintendo Mom who says, "You've printed tons of letters from kids and a few from dads. How about equal time for us moms? The NES is great. My favorite game is Tetris. Aww. I enjoy consistently beating my kids and husband at it. The only person I know who is better than I am is another mom. Maybe it's those years of experience creating order from chaos in our children's closets. I'm convinced that the NES is a learning tool. The adventures and RPGs give kids an incentive to read. Lots of the words are hard and some are in archaic language." I don't know what that's supposed to mean. "But my 10-year-old eats them up. My 8-year-old daughter's reading and directional perception have improved radically since she started playing Tetris and Super Mario Brothers. I have Mario to thank for teaching my 4 and 6-year-olds how to take turns cheerfully. What other activity improves fine motor coordination, teaches map making, logic and problem solving, and is fun at the same time? At our house, playing Nintendo is a privilege, not a right. Chores are done speedily with no complaints, and there are very few arguments, especially when we have a new game in the house. Thanks, Nintendo. I think you're wonderful."
That's really sweet. Right? That's very autobiographical for me because my own mom this is true. Like, I don't know if I've shared this on Scoop. Like, we would finish dinner and we would do the dishes, and then she would go to the basement and play Tetris. And like, she's not a gamer, like she's not, but like, she was one of those Tetris addicted moms and would take over the NES and take over the television and was a whiz at it. Like, you know, blocks flying everywhere, overwhelmingly the best one in the house. I think she probably would have beaten this Nintendo mom.
No. The world will never know. This is a letter from Jimmy Klepik, who says, I'm in the fourth grade at Barnett Elementary in Fairbanks, Alaska.
Don't share that. Now we know your name and where you live, Jimmy.
Well, back then. This year for my school science project, I chose a science problem I would like to share with you. I wanted to find out if people who play Nintendo have better eye-hand coordination. I thought this would be interesting because a lot of children play the NES. I tested about 50 students in my school with my eye-hand coordination tester. The data from my experiment showed that students who play Nintendo more have better eye-hand coordination. I won a blue ribbon and a medal for my school district science fair. I was then asked to go to the state science fair in Anchorage, Alaska, where I won a blue ribbon for my grade. I learned a lot about scientific method.
That's pretty legit.
It's good. I would like to know what his eye-hand coordination tester was. But
It was like ping pong balls in a cup or something. Yeah.
We had a hand-eye coordination test where you held your hand out and then they dropped a ruler and then you had to snap your hand around the ruler as fast as you could. Yeah,
that's good.
And then wherever you snapped it is like the other ruler tells you.
Yeah, I guess that was less hand-eye
coordination.
That's
more of a reaction time.
Yeah.
That's cool.
We can go to the next page here, Tom. There's a contest to get your name in a game, and it was all based around Final Fantasy. It says, have you ever imagined yourself in an NES game? Well, this is your chance. If you meet Warmech, who's a boss in Final Fantasy, snap a photo of him and send it to the address below by October 15th. One winner will be randomly selected, and his or her name will be programmed into a future Nintendo game.
Did that happen?
Yeah, did that happen? It didn't even say what game it would be.
Yeah, but also, Warmech is at the end
there's
of the
game.
There's
a fan in...
go ahead,
Sam. Oh, yeah. Well, there's a fan name and Link to the Past.
Yeah, the Chris Houlihan room, I think, right? No, Warmech is at the end of the game, and it's on this bridge, and you only have a 1 in 64 chance. It's a random chance of, like, it's a random encounter in that game. And, like, so most players will never, ever see Warmech or find him. It was kind of this, you know, I don't know how notorious it was back in 1990, but it's got, you know, it's developed, like, a reputation now. Mm.
I like the little...
I just named my characters Mark, so yeah. I was in every game back then.
Cool.
And you could fit your name in this game because it only had four letters. This was this year and this issue, like, I was so into Final Fantasy I these years.
Yeah.
1990, man, that game was so popular.
Same. And I like this little illustration of a person taking the photo of their screen. It looks like they're playing Zelda. And I like how the illustrator just added a cat in there. Maybe they just like cats.
Yeah.
Cat doesn't have to be there.
Dude, that was like, I've seen videos about how impossible that was, that you would send, like, you'd have to take a picture, you'd have to wait for it to get developed.
Yeah.
And then most of the time the picture would just be nothing. Like, it would just be because it like would flash on the screen and you couldn't see what it was anyway. So it's like, and like film, you had to wait till like all 25 pictures were taken. Like, that's so funny.
Next page is a big feature.
You had to use your parents' camcorder and then put that on a television and then pause it and take a picture of that.
Yep. The next page is a big feature on Maniac Mansion, which was very impactful for me, very influential. Like Shadowgate, it was a game that, you know, it just completely captivated me and sort of like set the tone for what I love to do in video games, which is just explore. Explore a cool environment.
Why did this game get an M rating? It's like, oh, it's,
I mean,
you microwave a hamster. So.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I mean, that had to be removed from the game. But I had the copy where you could microwave the hamster. That's good.
Oh.
Next up, we have the top 30. And I don't know how these are determined. It's determined by the magazine.
Oh, my gosh. It must have been such BS. I think it's what they wanted to sell the most of.
I mean, probably, yeah. But in the top 30 at this time, Mario Brothers 3 at number 1. Then Final Fantasy appeared for the first time at number 2.
Yeah, so
it's
cool.
It's got points.
Yeah.
Mario 3 has 24,964 points.
Yeah, but Final Fantasy only has 6,000 points.
What? Does it say? Does it say?
No,
there's no explanation.
It's been a long-standing mockery. Oh. I think, you know, they could have like pulled some group somewhere, but like 30,000 is a pretty big number. I don't.
It's one thing to like, we have a top 30 game, and we're not gonna like whatever. Don't worry about how they're picked. But just the points for some reason that really tickles me.
The rest of the top 10 on the next page is Ninja Gaiden 2, Super Mario Bros. 2, so that and 3 are both in the top 5. Mega Man 2, Tetris, Zelda 2, Batman, and Battle of Olympus.
Oh.
Yeah, it's like, cool. Well, I don't know why that's in there.
Is someone just pay? Is this all just like pay to play?
I mean,
like,
maybe.
It's the Battle of Olympus Pit. They're like, well, you didn't pay enough to get into the top five, but we'll put you at number 10.
The original Zelda.
I mean, you know that's happening because that Dragon Warrior is in that column on the right. And it's like, nope, nobody played Dragon. They couldn't give away Dragon Warrior.
Number 11 is the original Zelda. And then 12 is my man, Shadowgate. And then, and then we have a couple Shadowgate questions on the next page in the counselor's corner. But I wanted to point out the gameplay counselor profile. So first of all, the first one, Mike Frazier. His hobbies are medical research. So like he's like a video game call-in counselor for a living, but his hobby is medical research.
That is an incredibly sus answer to the question of what are your hobbies. Oh my God.
Maybe he's in grad school.
His highest game score is that he finished Kid Cool in 1 hour and 48 minutes.
I mean, sure.
And let's see, next one was Hans Lowe, who says his hobbies are skiing, drawing, boating, traveling, and bungee cord jumping. Now, I think most people who bungee jump do it once.
Yeah, sure, but that's just his hobby.
He just does it all the time?
Yeah.
He's just always bungee jumping.
He's an extreme guy.
Yeah, definitely.
Can you talk about sus, Justin, highest game score. Finish Ninja Gaiden without looking at the screen.
No.
No, I don't think so.
No. It happens on Awesome Games Done Quick.
That's no way.
That's a good point. Someone beat Punch Out blindfolded.
Yeah, but that happened after 30 years of people learning that game.
He didn't need 30 years. He did it between 1988 and 1990.
Punch Out versus Ninja Gaiden, like, man.
Yeah, no way.
That's got to be tough.
I don't know that I believe know. He beat Ninja Gaiden without looking at the screen. I don't
you
know.
Just got to time it to that beat.
And then below that, Ed Ridgway, his hobbies are basketball and anything competitive.
Okay.
Cool. Anything.
From him. His highest game score. Medical research.
Oh, there it is.
His highest game score is that he finished Castle Quest.
Okay.
He just finished it.
Yeah. I don't know what Castle Quest is. That doesn't ring a bell.
The next page is a special feature on Game Boy, and there's at least one cart that was never released in the U.S., the Popeye cart in the bottom right there. Mm. Even though Nintendo,
do you think
of course,
it was based on the arcade game?
No, on the next page, you can see a screen that it's like a top-down puzzle game in the bottom left.
Weird.
But from Sunsoft?
No, it's from Sega.
I don't think it's it.
It's from Sega. So this one, Nintendo did not have the license anymore. But that game was not released in the U.S.
Yeah.
Stay clear of Pets
Sata
and Hamburgers
and
Brutus.
And King. Yeah, that looks kind of fun.
I can tell that you're rescuing Sweet Pea in that third screenshot.
It says bring your love to olive oil and bring olive to the big heart. Okay. The next stage is, or the page is the directory.
Well, hold on.
Go back
one. So Balloon Kid.
Yeah.
That is a sequel to Balloon Fight.
Yes.
Which is awesome.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then it got remade as a Hello Kitty game on, and then ported back to the NES, and it's awesome.
Really?
And those are and the NES game. Long story short, they're in Nintendo developed games. Like that Hello Kitty game is a Nintendo developed game, and it's really cool.
Weird.
And you play as a balloon kid. That's a girl in this, which is unusual outside of Metroid for Nintendo made games at the time.
Spoilers.
And you play through it, and it's like a full on like adventure game with bosses and like really cool levels. That game is very underappreciated, and it's super cool.
Yes, as everyone knows, there's a code you can input in Metroid to turn Samus into a girl.
Mm. Yeah, and then later there was a balloon fight that's just stars Tingle.
Oh, Tingle's balloon fight? That's cool. The next page is the directory of Game Boy games, and it says, just 1 year ago, Nintendo introduced the revolutionary handheld video game system known as Game Boy. It was an immediate smash success. New games for the system are pouring out of the labs all over the world. Like, Game Boy games came out of laboratories?
Yeah, where they do their medical research.
Yeah.
Is this just a list of every Game Boy game? I think
this is a list of every game available 1 year in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think that made a lot of sense because you look at the first year.
Yeah.
Like, it's like there are so few things. They're like, look how many games there are now because all the shovelware hit. Actually, this list is pretty good. I mean, look at the arcade ports on here. That's kind of cool. Quirk. It's a game about a tomato.
Yep, it is good. And number five from the top, I like, is Boomer's Adventure, which would be a different game if it were made today.
No.
Boomer's Adventure in Asmic World. I owned that game, and it's really fun.
You're like
it's
a little pink dinosaur.
Puzzly. Yeah, pink dinosaur, exactly.
Okay. The next page is the previews, and because it's like a fall October issue, they've got pumpkins with screenshots on them. A little bit lazy, I think. It looks just be like, okay, it's all
right. It looks so Scholastic Journal, like they got a page from like, you know, the Highlights magazine. Exactly. They just slapped their own stuff over it.
It's really, really good. Now I point out they've got the Ninja Turtles 2 the arcade game on the next page, which of course has like the box art with the, like the cartoon-ish versions of the turtles.
Oh yeah.
But on the next page they have the comic book version of the turtles. They're mixing turtle art styles here in their preview. I don't think I would have minded at the time. And then the next page, fall favorites, new games now available. I like this illustration here.
It's really good.
Wow. It's also from, like, it looks like it's Highlights Magazine. And let me describe what's happening
here. Is mom playing NES while the kid goes to school?
Yes. Outside, this kid is running to catch the bus, and they've paused their game. They've left their game paused inside. Oh. And we can see that mom is now.
This is clearly, this is like a Norman Rockwell take. Like clearly what's going on here, like some kind of Americana. Like this is, I was laughing at this at first because I thought it was silly, but I actually understand now that it's a parody, right? Like, okay, I get it.
But like, wait, zoom in on the TV again.
Yeah, this is Reader's Digest. Like this is.
Look at this NES. This NES is like the width, the thickness of a slice of bread. It's like so thin.
the ratio.
It's as thin as the
redesign that ever came out.
This one also has a cat.
This one also
has
a cat.
Look? That's a really good depiction of a cat.
The cat's very interested in what mom is going to play.
Yeah.
It's good.
Wait, is she going to unpause his game and play?
Yeah, she's going to play it.
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
Yep. It's when great.
He's almost to the mech boss in Final Fantasy, and she's going to ruin it.
I don't know what game just has a pause screen like that with just a pause word that big.
Yeah, she's gonna grind out War Mech. Yeah.
Maybe she's playing Frankenstein, because that's being previewed here. Next page is Gauntlet 2, and I just liked the big little profiles of all the characters, Warrior, Valkyrie, and the Wizard, and the Elf. Sam, do you remember if these ports, the NES ports of Gauntlet 1 and 2, if they have any of the voice recordings that the...
I don't think so. I can tell you that they had the...
I think they did.
There was a black cart bootleg version of it, and then a licensed version of it.
Yeah.
Both from Tengen, which is Atari.
I mean, I can't trust my memory, but like... I have a memory of like, oh, fighter need food. And like, I think I was playing that on the internet.
It could be. I mean, it probably does because Bayou Valley has that. Their adventures are
there are some games. Tecmo Bowl has, you know.
Dribble.
Hurt.
Yeah.
Hurt.
It has all that stuff.
Yeah, yeah. I think it would have it in there. And look at that little screenshot there. It's like arcade or NES. We can't tell the difference. I bet it was pretty accurate.
The next page is Dick Tracy, which I wanted to point out for a couple of reasons. First is like, it's just weird that at the summer that this movie came out, it was the biggest movie of the year. It was like, there was this big promotion with McDonald's and Al Pacino's in it, Madonna's in it. It was this huge deal. But like, this movie has not had a life afterwards. Like, no one talks about or watches Dick Tracy today.
It was an open
world.
Wasn't
Madonna in it?
Yeah, that's what I just said. Madonna was in it.
Yeah, I had this game. I played this game. It's not good.
No, it's not good.
Yeah, but it's not a good game.
I think it was like one. It was like a big open placement. Like that's what they're showing.
That's why I'm going to show this map. Yeah. I guess it's probably the whole, the whole play area. But I can't make heads or tails of like what anything is.
No, but like I think that was like kind of pretty cool for the time, right? Like
probably, it might have been
big
cool.
Open play space.
It might have been cool for the time.
Looks like an arcade PC board.
Yeah, it does look like that.
It does.
The next page is a game I think Sam knows. Barker Bill's Trick Shooting.
Oh, yeah. The unofficial kind of sequel to Duck Hunt.
Because the light gun
people don't know about. Yeah, it has the dog from Duck Hunt in it.
Is it unofficial? It's not a Nintendo game?
No. Sorry, I didn't mean it that way. Okay, I just meant that they didn't call it.
Spiritual
they
successor.
Didn't call it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's Barker Bill is apparently the name of the dog that laughs at you.
Ah, okay.
Oh,
there he is back there. See him?
Yeah.
Everyone tried to shoot the dog.
Yep.
Yep.
The next game has Circus. The next game is Circus Capers, which is notable because it's from Toho, and Godzilla and Rodan make an appearance in that game.
Cool.
Even though it's just about being at a circus.
Just a day at the circus with Godzilla and Rodan.
And below is Mad Max, a game that I rented, but I don't really remember anything about. I don't think it was very remarkable.
Although, I remember this preview of it because I love that guy with the mohawk and I really wanted to play the game.
Yeah, well, I mean, except that guy is also in Skate or Die, basically.
They're filming Fury.
Which is supposed to be like...
Yeah, I mean, or it's already filmed, yeah.
I didn't think it was ever like going to be real.
I know.
You know that guy in Skate or Die is Rodney Dangerfield? He's supposed to be like a punk.
Yeah, it's
Rodney
like a trace. Yeah, like a trace of Rodney Dangerfield. Yeah.
Yeah, and his name is Rodney.
That's a little on the nose.
The next page
has so weird.
Rally Bike, a game I'm not familiar with, and then Cabal, which was a SNK Neo Geo arcade game, and then there's Narc, a game that's amazing. It was ported to the NES. If anyone doesn't know Narc, seek it out.
Not a great port.
Seek it out on YouTube. It was like the most over the top, ridiculously violent arcade game at the time. In the first stage, Marky, do you know this game?
No, it rhymes with my name, though.
It does. In the first stage, you roll up as a police officer, presumably, in a convertible, but you're wearing a motorcycle helmet, and you jump out of the convertible onto the street. You're dual-wielding machine guns, and you have a sleeveless shirt on. Yep. And then you indiscriminately gun down every drug dealer in your path.
Yep.
Every single one.
Should we try to arrest them?
No arrests.
Any due process? No, they're just
gunned down,
fucking murdered.
Now, to be fair, they're throwing giant syringes at you.
Yeah, they do throw syringes.
They're throwing giant syringes at you.
And then you also have like...
They're trying to get you hooked.
You also have a rocket launcher, and if you shoot at them, their bodies explode into bloody burning pieces all over the screen. And best believe that 12-year-old Damon thought that was the coolest thing ever.
So does Damon now.
Yeah, so does 45-year-old Damon.
Yeah.
But the NES port, no, not good. Not good. And then on the next page...
Did you get to play that?
What's that?
Did you play the arcade game then?
Oh, yeah.
Like you played it in the arcade?
Every time I went to King Louis Bowling Alley and Ice Skating Rink in Overland Park, Kansas, I pumped quarters into Narc.
It's probably still there.
Nice, yeah. It was a Midway game. And also, shout out, if you are going to look that game up, watch the final boss. It's like a mutant version of MODOK.
Yeah, it is. It's good. I think it's just called Big Boss, too.
Drugs will do that to you.
Next game, next page. Super Famicom announced in Japan. This is 1990.
Awesome. Wow, really? 1990?
Yeah, I think maybe they're behind on the reporting. Because I think it was going to be released that holiday season, that winter.
A prototype design looks so cool.
Yeah, that's not the final. It just has all orange buttons, it looks like. Mm-hmm. Interesting, yeah. And then it says Nintendo has so far announced 3 Super Famicom titles, all of which should come out in Japan. Super Mario World, Mario Rides a Dinosaur, and gains even more power-ups. Flight Club, a super flight simulator, and F-Zero, a hot racing game. So Flight Club became Pilot Wings.
Yeah, Flight Club's a cute name.
Those screenshots of Mario are amazing. And what's weird is that even though I just told you I remember parts of this issue and everything, I don't remember them previewing the Super Nintendo at all. I don't remember any of this.
Those screenshots.
I wasn't aware of it until it came out.
Those screenshots are pretty notorious because I don't like those moments. Like those, they're not in Super Mario World, right? Like to my memory, is like that exact moment and that exact scene didn't make it into the final game.
That neither of those look familiar.
Yeah, look at that map.
That open world, that looks more like Mario's Missing than Super Mario World.
I do want to shout out, sometimes the layout of these magazines is just awful, but I like the little drop shadow they've done behind the screenshots here. That looks nice.
Yeah,
I like that too.
That looks nice. Mm-hmm. On the next page is a celebrity profile of Will Wheaton from Star Trek The Next Generation. I thought Sam would know him since you're a Star Trek fan.
Oh, yeah, everybody
knows. Of course I know Will Wheaton. Okay. Will Wheaton's still in Star Trek. He is now like a time-hopping super god for some reason that they introduced in the end of the second Picard season.
Things have taken a weird turn there.
So I
know
Will Wheaton,
from Big Bang Theory.
Actor Will Wheaton plays it cool between takes with NES Ice Hockey.
Ice Hockey.
Mm-hmm. Oh, cool.
It's new from World of Nintendo on the next page. NES accessories. I love there's an electronic Super Mario Bros. 3 toothbrush. Mario.
I thought that was an inhaler.
So did I.
Yeah, I thought the next one was an inhaler, but that's a telephone. It says Mario's on the line. It features mute and redial buttons. And then
redial was a big deal.
The next one is the Play-A-Toon musical book, which contains a mini keyboard and fun Nintendo tunes to the right there.
Do you remember dialing *69* to see what number just called your house?
Yeah.
But then I think, and I actually don't know if this is true, if this is a rumor, but you could dial *67* to stop someone from *69*ing before you called their number. Like it was like it anonymized you. I don't know how any of that worked.
Yeah.
Dude, I can't imagine ever doing that now. Like, if if you're not like in my contacts list, it's just like, you know, from some town, even if it's the town I live in, I'm like, I don't know about this. I can't imagine missing a call and being like, *69, hi, you just called me.
Yeah.
I would never do
who
that.
Who's calling me?
I would never do
anyone,
that.
Anyone listening to this show that's under like the age of 30, they have no idea what we're talking about.
I know. On the next page, they talk about this a Super Mario Bros. 3 cartoon that was coming up, but I don't know if that just became the Super Mario Bros. Super Show.
Interesting.
No, it was after the Super
Look
Show.
At that art, that's great.
So there was just a dedicated Mario 3 cartoon.
Yeah, I think what they did was the Super Show predated Mario 3. So then they did some. They might have done the segments in the Super Show, but they switched to Mario 3, or it was standalone. I can't remember which one it was, but they definitely switched to like a different animation and like included the Koopa Kids and stuff.
And then below that, it says they're apparently prepping a Maniac Mansion TV show with Lucasfilm Limited Television. And Eugene Levy was apparently going to star.
Right.
Wasn't there like one made for TV movie or something that they came out for?
Not for Maniac Mansion.
That would have been
no,
great.
For sure.
Yeah, for sure. But you know, it does make some sense since Lucasfilm, you know,
it's going to be on the Family Channel.
Yeah.
Whatever that was.
There he is.
It's too tight on Eugene Levy's face.
Real tight.
On the next page, PacWatch has the Miracle Piano Teaching System, which was just shown off at CES. This is hot news. The TV is on fire. This news is so hot.
Cool.
Sam, was this actually released?
I was right. Maniac Mansion did air.
No way. There's a Maniac Mansion TV special?
It had three seasons, 1990 to 1993.
Three seasons?
It was developed by George Lucas, Rick McCallum, Eugene Levy, and it starred Joe Flaherty, Deborah Theaker, Kathleen Robinson, Avi Phillips, and George Buza.
Whoa, that's awesome.
My God.
We got to find it. Is it Lost Media?
It's on YouTube, so.
Yes.
Guess that's what I'm doing.
Yep, I got my evening plans sorted.
I'm watching
the whole Maniac Halloween weekend.
That's awesome.
Well, yeah. Okay, the season one intro is on here, and what I'm seeing is actually the 10th anniversary special.
Ah,
so I don't know.
We'll figure it out.
Okay. Well, I stand corrected. I'm sorry for doubting you, Sam. We'll wrap this up. Did this $300 piano accessory game ever come out, Sam?
Yeah, so I have this cartridge, and the pianos, a friend of mine who is involved in music stuff and education, found like a storage unit of these that were like used in a school of the pianos. It was like hitting me up about like, you know, do you think we can get these up and running and is this worth it? I was like, absolutely not. But like, I freaking want one.
Yeah.
But it never came through, but I have the cartridge.
Okay.
Yeah, the metronome plays through the TV, but the music comes from the piano, so it's like kind of hard to
weird.
To like,
interesting.
You know, hear it. Yeah. You have to blast the TV.
Is that Donald Trump?
It's a great
corner?
Idea.
I can't tell.
Dudley Moore.
Oh, okay.
Speaking of, if you're under 30, you'll have no idea who Dudley Moore is. Arthur II on the rocks.
I'm over 30 and I still don't know.
I know. In the gossip section on the next page, not since King Kong battled Godzilla has there been such a monster mash as Aliens versus Predator, a scenario already explored by Dark Horse Comics, blah, blah, blah. Activision is planning on producing an NES game pitting the two famous creatures against each other. That would go on to be a super NES game. It would never make it to NES. Then on the next page, get ready for Magnet Man, Snake Man, Needle Man, Hard Man, Top Man, Gemini Man, Spark Man, and Shadow Man. That's just a sampling of the 20 new super robots in Mega Man 3 on the
20.
Way. No, there's just 8 robot masters, like all of them. Unless I just can. And I don't know why there's a picture of a mermaid below there. Below the.
Something weird happened with Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade because we ended up with 2 of them. And I think there's something about these screenshots that show a third one.
There's 2 games on the NES?
Yeah, there's 2 Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade games.
They also showcase Dragon's Lair, which is just abysmal on the NES.
Maybe that was just like, it was a miscommunication. They're like, wait, you made a Last Crusade? We already made that game, guys.
Yeah.
Oh, well, I guess we made it twice.
It says to capture
Oh, and then this is famous. The New Kids game, that only got box art, but that was sold in auction maybe 10, 15 years ago. And somebody owns that like box art, but the game... We've never found the ROM or like any semblance of a playable version.
Interesting. It also said that Toho had a Rodan game coming, but that never came.
Ah.
Yep.
Oh, that would have been cool.
Yeah. And that's it. That's the October issue of Nintendo Power from 1990.
Great issue.
That was a good one.
Yep, that is a really good one. That brings us to Video Game 20 Questions. Our suggestion this week comes from Greg in Nahant, Massachusetts. Hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. Nahant! Thank you for the correction, Producer Tom. Let the questioning begin.
I also want to shout out that Tom's hands, scans, and zooms were really awesome during that segment.
That was great.
So people that are watching, who want the extra mile in producing this episode, yep. Really
except
cool. New kids on the block.
Except for, except for when he lingered so tight on Eugene Levy. That was too much. I don't need that sway right up in my business. I don't want to ask the magazine. The odds of it of having appeared in the 1990 issue of Nintendo Power are low. Did this game...
How about is it spooky?
Yeah, okay. Does this game... Is this a spooky game?
Not spooky, but season appropriate.
Oh, it's probably costume.
Oh, cool.
I don't know why. It's like, 'cause it's fall. I live in the Midwest now, and so we get actual seasons, and it's fall, and I've been thinking about fall games, and I was reading some video game features on like the best games to play in fall, like the best cozy fall games, and Costume Quest came up, and I'm like, oh, man. What a nice game.
Oh, that was cool. Maybe that's it. Maybe that's the game.
Yeah.
Let's get into two questions.
Yeah. How can we narrow this down? Is this a role-playing game?
Yes.
Do it.
Do you play as children?
Just ask it.
There's a Halloween party in the office to get to.
No, we'll never beat this. We'll never beat this score.
It's risky, guys.
No,
I think we should do it.
No way.
He has another game. I'm sure he has another game we can play if we lose.
Is it Costume Quest?
Yes. Three questions. And actually, I mean, you set it up the first question.
Yeah, it could have been in two. You did give us a big hint, though.
Yeah, maybe I shouldn't have given you the hint, but whatever.
No, it's fine. Who cares?
It's all a good book.
Yeah.
Costume Quest, yeah.
I have a real... Like, I don't know what, like, this isn't, like, look, I do like this game. I really like this game, but, like, it over-indexes in my brain for how good it is, for, like, how often I think about it. Like, every fall, this game's, like, on my mind. Like, it's so cute and cozy, and the premise is so clever. If you don't know what it is, it's about a group of kids. You can see them here in the B-roll. They go around trick-or-treating and solving little Halloween mysteries. Like, the different levels is, like, a section in the mall and a section in your neighborhood. And each costume you wear is, like, a different role-playing game class. And so that's the conceit of the game is, like, you know, you're the superhero, you're the sword person. And, like, it's really cute. Like, it's really, like, Knights and Bikes is another game that sort of has this same vibe.
Oh, yeah.
And there's not enough games that kind of... I can't even really articulate what the vibe is, but just kind of like cozy, cutesy, fun games to play in the fall.
Yeah.
It's also like a not mean South Park. Like, it has funny jokes, and it's about kids that are being kids, but it's not gross and
it's
mean.
It's very wholesome. And it's like, actually, like, I really like South Park Stick of Truth, but the gameplay is similar and the vibe of it is similar, of kind of going around this neighborhood and being a cute kid. And even, you know, they're very similar, except that it's not like gross out humor and South Park humor. It's just sort of wholesome humor. Great game.
Is that a 20 questions record?
It will be unbroken.
Wow. I think so. Wow. Yeah,
we could have
two versions. Not only was it barely any questions, but Justin just did it on his own.
Well, but Damon, again, he gave us the big clue.
I asked if it was spooky.
Yeah.
Oh, that's right.
He said,
that's
give
right.
me something okay. spooky.
So fuck you, Mark.
The guy said he wanted something spooky.
Yeah, we only gave it a 7.5, but...
They made a seem short.
That gives me 33% of the questions. I also wanted to add that I moved into a neighborhood that's like super, super focused on trick or treating.
So fun.
And it's the funniest, coolest thing.
Yes. Sorry. Listeners, you got to watch this episode. This is an episode to watch.
Just watch it. Oh, no.
Nicely.
I like the slide.
Nicely. Oh, I get some extension there.
There we go.
Okay, thank you for the suggestion. Who did that come from? Someone in Nahant. What was their name? Oh, I'm all screwed up here. I'm locked out of my computer now.
Thank you, listener.
Thank you, listener Greg in Manhattan, Massachusetts. There you go. Viewers, listeners, if you have your own suggestions for 20 questions, email them to me at the email address gamescoop@ign.com. And Justin is right. We are having a Halloween party in the office tonight. So we're going to skedaddle onto that. Wish Sam and Mark were here to join us.
I signed up for the caramel apple decorating contest. Oh,
there you go. There you go. My wife carved a pumpkin last night, so we'll see. We'll see if we can win anything there. Always a pleasure having you in the flesh, Justin.
I love it.
Thank you to both Sam and Mark. Thank you to producer Tom, being just the best producer of any show out there. Just the best producer. Oh yeah, Mark is Knuff, as always.
I am Knuff.
Wonderful costume art. My name is Damon. Thanks. This is IGN Game Spook, and we're out.
Live my life like a gremlin. I don't need any water.
There we go.
Don't need very much sleep. Don't need to exercise. There's no way that any of this could come back to to bite me ever. It's fine.
What's the biology of a gremlin or a mogwai? So they can't. Does their body not need water?
But they can't get wet. They can't get wet after midnight. But until when?
No. Like, that's just the eating. Water is anytime.
No, but they can't eat after midnight. But when are they allowed to? After midnight? No, it doesn't.
Yeah. When can they eat?
What if they're on an airplane that's traveling across time zones?
And then if one of those things happens but not the others, do you not have gremlin babies?
No.
The water. Because
water is how they multiply.
And then the food.
The food is what turns the mogwais into gremlins.
Right.
That's why when he gets wet, he gets the bubbles on his back, but they just look like mogwais. Yeah. But they're kind of evil.
They are. They're very mischievous.
Should I show gremlins to? Can the girls watch that movie?
Yeah,
six and nine.
The 9-year-old for sure.
They need to make an edit of that movie without the fucking Santa Claus story in it.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, maybe. Yeah, that's because the music turns dark. I mean, for the kids.
Well, but you also, with these 80s movies, you never know, like the whole thing is light and breezy and fine, and then there's like some random like blowjob joke, and it's like, that's how all those 80s movies
I don't think there's any of that in Gremlins,
but that's what those movies do.
I know,
They throw, that's like, it's 45 minutes in the movie, and you're like, oh!
Yeah.
It's like, that's why we can't show them Ghostbusters, is because the opening montage has that ghost blowjob scene in it.
Not the opening montage.
Oh, is it?
It's in the middle.
Yeah, in the middle.
Yeah, it does have that. Although I think when I saw it as a kid, I had no idea what was happening.
I know.
So. Me neither. I didn't until you just said that. I didn't know that shit was going on. I thought she was giving him a nice.
Either.
I hope Tom is getting
a nice hip massage.
Okay. All right. Everybody good to
I've
start?
I've never seen either of those movies. Can you hear me now, Tom?
Yeah,
good?
Yes.
Okay.
Wait. You haven't seen either of the G movies we were just talking about, Gremlins or Ghostbusters, or you haven't seen both Ghostbusters movies? Okay,
I haven't seen any Ghostbusters or Gremlins movies.
Okay, well, Gremlins
is
also...
I've seen Jurassic Park.
Gremlins is a Christmas movie, so watch that at Christmas time.
Mm. Oh, perfect.
Yeah.
I'll be too busy watching Die Hard for the first time. I thought you did
watch Die Hard. You never watched it?
Mm-mm. No. Okay.
Well, this
I've
is
seen one
thing?
Of the diehards, the one with Justin Long.
I think Brian Albert was forced to watch Die Hard in the office. Mm-hmm. That's what happened.
I remember that. I forgot about that.
Yeah. It was pre-Mark Medina.
There's really only one.
I worked with Brian Albert. Well, maybe not when he was watching Die Hard, though.
Yeah, you weren't forced to watch Die Hard.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, everybody good?
Yep.
I'm going to start.